Good morning, everybody. This is the Personal Playlist Podcast, fondly referred to as the P3, on VoiceEd Radio. I'm Noah Daniel.
Music is a world within itself, with a language we all understand.
I am so excited to have Greg Farrell here on the Personal Playlist Podcast. Greg is the 12th of 13 children born in Toronto to parents from St. John's, Newfoundland. He has 9 older sisters and 3 brothers and grew up in Toronto in Ontario housing. Growing up where he did exposed him to the richness and diversity that is now so common in the city of Toronto. The first in his family to graduate from university, Greg began his teaching career in a wonderful IB school just outside of Lisbon, Portugal. He's taught kindergarten to grade 12 and has also taught AQ courses for OISE. He was a VP and then a principal in YRDSB. Greg recently came back to York Region after a secondment to the Ministry of Education, where he served various school boards in the implementation of their specific goals. In addition, he worked with leaders to implement the Professional Learning Conversation Protocol as a catalyst for school improvement. Welcome to the show, Greg.
Thank you, Noah. Thanks so much. I'm happy to be here.
I'm happy to be here too with you. We actually first met during grade one orientation at Frechette, where you were the outgoing principal, and before our eldest daughter started there. And we met again a few years ago at Quest. And then in November, I had the wonderful privilege of sitting on this panel with you when the government of Ontario commissioned the independent review of assessment and reporting practices in the province in publicly funded schools, and VoiceEd Radio decided to make a space for an extended conversation where we really engaged in some deep thinking around assessment. And I personally was so honored to be part of the team where we got to experience this. So actually, what was it like for you to be on that panel?
It was such an amazing learning experience. It was great to hear the different thoughts and ideas across the province. And I think we are at a really wonderful time for change for EQAO. So I love the learning that was involved in it. It was my first experience with radio, but I loved it. It's great. So much learning. And I made some powerful connections with people across the province that I still keep in touch with.
It's so amazing. And that's one of the great parts about the VoiceEd Radio experience is it's this hub and it's really the beginning of a ripple. So it's nice to hear that you made connections that keep on giving. Among the things that you mentioned when we were talking about your accomplishments is you said you assisted with one of the first TED clubs in the province. Was that the one related to Will Gourley or a different one?
No, that was actually. So Will and I, we currently work together now at Adrian Clarkson Public School, but we worked together years ago at Sam Chapman Public School when I was able to open a brand new French Immersion School in York Region District School Board. And that was a phenomenal, enriching experience, opening a new school and then I guess harvesting the leadership and the creativity and the innovation of other teachers.
You know, I listened to your podcast with Derek, you and Will, and I was blown away. I have envied leadership. I've studied leadership. I've read about leadership, but the two of you together speaking, it was an embodiment of so much innovation and what it really means to build capacity. Everybody that works with you must feel so empowered and seen. It was an amazing thing to watch. I'm definitely going to listen to. I'm going to put the link in to the blog post that will come out on Tuesday. Okay. So the essence of this show, you're welcome. It was quite notable. The essence of this show is that people bring 3 songs to me, a nostalgic song, a song that reflects their identity, and a song that picks them up, lifts them up, motivates or inspires them. Tell me a little about the process of getting to these 3 songs.
This was not an easy journey. I can't tell you how agonizing it was and how I struggled with songs and ideas and times of my life. And I found this a really challenging endeavor. And I almost want to say that I think you choose songs from times in your life, and it's hard. I love music, and music comforts me and supports me. And, you know, I love to dance. I can't believe I didn't choose a disco song because I love the disco era and I love to dance. But, yeah, it was really, really tough.
Sorry, you got me singing a song. I like the nightlife.
No way.
I love to boogie. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I got a disco tangent, but that was fun. Listen, it's a hard, complex task. It seems straightforward. And like any kind of project, there are parameters, but people can create and do with it whatever they want. So when you discovered which was going to be your nostalgic song, what were the feelings and ideas that came up?
Well, I guess some of the feelings that I went through in choosing the nostalgic song was that I wanted something from a time in my life that I guess was a really important time. And I chose the song Old Black Joe because it was a song that my mother used to sing to my younger brother and I, put us to sleep at night. And it's a really tender and loving memory of the relationship between a parent and a child. And I remember her singing it, and I remember singing with her, and I remember just feeling a great love and a comfort and a readiness to go to sleep. So that song is almost dedicated to her and dedicated to families. And it's a controversial song, and it's a powerful song, and it reminds me just also of the struggle that minoritized people face in their life. And it reminds me of the toil. It started off as an African spiritual before it was adapted and changed. And it reminds me of my mom. So what a better memory can you have?
You can't. And actually, a lot of people have had that as a memory of, this sentimental nighttime song. And because through the process of trying to become a more equitable society, people had changed the song actually to Old Blind Joe. And they tried to paint over some of the story. But the lyrics tell a story, and they were written by a person who was looking at a Black man and feeling empathy and wondering about his life. So like all things historical, they need to be understood in context, and they need to be unpacked. So anyway, I think that there are a lot of really valuable things about looking at music in a critical way, mm-hmm. but also to enjoy things in their time. And in its time, this was a song that your mom sang to you, and there's nothing purer or truer than that. Here is the song, Old Black Joe. So Stephen Foster composed this. Paul Robinson version has like the depth of the spiritual aspects of the song. I thought it was a really interesting version choice.
I also remember my mom played the piano, although we didn't grow up with a piano in our home. But I remember her taking her harmonica up to the bedroom with us. And it was so exciting to watch my mom play the harmonica and sing with us.
Wow. So she would do that at nighttime?
Yeah, if you can imagine raising 13 children, but making sure her two youngest sons, nestle down in bed and have a good night's sleep. It's a beautiful memory.
We were just talking about choosing a version. And when I saw your identity song, I was so interested by the version because I knew the Leonard Cohen version. But The Nina Simone version is another story altogether. So explain how you get to this song and the Priestess of Souls version of it.
Yeah, the High Priestess of Soul. I discovered Nina Simone, I want to say about 35 years ago. When I first heard the voice, I was just mesmerized and wasn't even sure if it was a man or a woman. I just, it kind of just enthralled me. And so I remember buying my first greatest, you know, Nina Simone's greatest collection, greatest hits, and just loving it and listening to it all the time and wanting to sing like her and sound like her and memorize the words to her songs. And, you know, then I've throughout the years of being amazed by this powerful woman and this powerful musician, I've come to know a little bit about her history and her role as an activist, her journey as a classically trained pianist, and, you know, then discovering her own voice. And Girlfriend Can Dance. So if you watch any of her videos, you can see her just moving in such beautiful, fluid ways. And, you know, her life in France and how she left the United States. You know, her parents were not permitted to sit in the front row when she started performing. So I learned all that afterwards, but I fell in love with her voice. And I also love the poetry of Leonard Cohen. And my husband and I recently were in Montreal and saw Leonard Cohen's exhibition. And so I thought, what a great...
I heard that was a phenomenal exhibition, by the way.
Yeah, it was very creative. I wanted more, but it was very creative, and it really got you inside of his mind, and what an innovator and, you know, creative genius that he was. So, you know, in choosing this song, I got to choose to an amazing poet and then an amazing writer and, you know, a singer. So I combined two people that I really admire and respect into an identity song. So, yeah, I love her work and I love his work. So there you have it.
Okay, well, let's play the Nina Simone version of Suzanne.
Suzanne takes you down to a place by the river. You can hear the boats go by. You can spend the night forever. And you know that she's half crazy, and that's why you want to be there. And she feeds you tea and oranges that come all the way from China. And just when you mean to tell her that you have no love to give her, she gets you on her wavelength, and she lets the river answer that you've always been her lover. You, or you touched her perfect body with your mind, yeah. Now Jesus was a sailor when he walked upon the water, and he spent a long time watching from his lonely wooden tower. And when he knew for certain only drowning men could see him, he said all men will be sailors then until the sea shall free them. Yeah, 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 yeah. But he himself was broken long before the sky would open, forsaken, almost human. He sank beneath your wisdom like a stone. And you won't travel with him, and you won't travel blind.
she leads you to the river. She's wearing rags and feathers from Salvation Army counters, and the sun pours down like honey on Our Lady of the Harbor, and she shows
It's a whole other version.
Yeah, the imagery is so powerful, and her voice is stunning.
It really is. It's just, it's stunning, and the depth of the soul of that song changes so much because of the spectrum of sound.
And did you notice that she changed it from, you know, a she to a he? You know, you want to follow her, and then you want to be with her, and then you want to follow him. I thought that was really interesting. I never noticed that before, how she switches the gender of...
I actually didn't notice it, but in the narrative that was playing in my head, I actually saw what you're saying.
Yeah. Nina Simone can take you places. When she sings David Bowie's version of The Wild as the Wind, you have to listen to that as well, Noah. It's unbelievable.
I totally... Wild as the Wind? Oh, there was a David Bowie tribute last night, actually, that I missed in the city.
Oh, cool.
Okay, I'll happily look into that. Thank you for the suggestion. It's interesting when you told her backstory, because I think it relates so much to the identity that you shared with me about coming in as a VP to York Region and the development of an awareness of collaborative professionalism and equity and leadership. There's so much power in the choices that you've made so far and in connecting to like what it means to be an inclusionary educator and what it means to, you know, embed inquiry. What else about that song says something about you?
It reminds me of a character first I think you're enraptured by the character, you want to be with them, but it just reminds me also of the different types of people that we come across. And, you know, it reminds me of being empathetic to those who are going through, physical or mental challenges. It helps, you know, to remind me that there are many different people out there. And, you know, Suzanne is a really captivating character, but she's very different and very unique. And, you know, you go to her and you learn from her. So it reminds me about an inclusive stance that I try to take with people. And it reminds me of how, differences are can provide us with richness. And, you know, teaching is really is often such a middle class endeavor. How do we how do we make sure that we open the door for all identities, all people, all of those, regardless of all of the capital that they bring or their own journey? You know, yeah, so that's those are some of my thoughts.
It is the most worthy endeavor in not just teaching every child, but seeing every child in order to teach them, mm-hmm. and knowing the possibility that education can bring for people. I mean, look at you. Look at where you came from and where you are. I can't imagine that's not a tribute to perseverance and education.
Yeah. I mean, even just getting my own undergrad was such a challenge, I think I dropped out four times from post-secondary, and there was a really unique program at York University. You could start in February and get a full year in by June. And that year, after leaving Glendon, after leaving UBC, after really struggling to find my place in post-secondary, that once I got those four credits, you were not stopping me. I was finishing that degree, and I always wanted to be a teacher. So it was a dream come true, a very hard journey. I'm having the same, issues with post-secondary again, trying to start a master's or complete a master's. I can't tell you how many programs I've started and dropped out of. I think we're currently at five. But at one point in my life, I hope to have a master's in education. But it's a long and hard journey for me as well.
You know what? The master's program I applied to originally, I didn't get into. And I was so upset. And my husband said to me, is that the right program for you? And I was so busy waiting to get accepted that I never really asked the question. And I actually did my master's at OISE in adult ed. Awesome. And what I got to do with that is I got to take all the curriculum related courses, but I got to really develop my facilitation skills, which, you know, work very well for me right now, but I didn't know I was going to go there. I just knew that I liked to do workshops for teachers and parents. So that's where I was focusing my degree. But that really did make a very big difference for me. I learned things that I never thought I would have learned, like consulting skills and proprioceptive writing. It was just such a neat experience. And I may not have immersed myself in all aspects of the adult ed because I really did want to develop in curriculum and took a lot of the other courses. I think that made the difference for me. So maybe that will make the difference for you. But it sounds like your story is about your own journey on your own time. Yeah. So if that's something you want to do, I don't doubt that you'll achieve that.
Yeah, thank you.
Going back to what could also have been your identity song, but you chose it as your pick-me-up song. The band actually originally wrote this song in Berlin for Achtung Baby, and then repurposed it with Mary J. Blige, and who sang with Bono in 2006 for a benefit for victims of Hurricane Katrina, and then recorded it on her album, Reminisce. When you had the pick-me-up song choice, why was it this charted classic? What was it that speaks to you about it?
Well, I often come back to that song when I feel like I need a readjustment or a realignment. And I respect Bono for all of his social justice work. And Mary J. Blige can sing like it's nobody's business. And I love the fact that they came together to help, you know, people who needed it. Mary J. Blige in her own right is such an amazing actress and writer and performer and social advocate. So I, you know, if you notice in both and all of my songs, I try to squeeze in as much as I can. So yeah, the words for this song are so powerful, and I find it uplifting and reassuring, and just a powerful reminder about when we come together, you know, the possibilities are limitless.
Yeah, I can't help but conjure the chorus.
Well, it just reminds me how, you know, we are sometimes in service to one another. So, you know, the power of helping people, that's what I love about my job right now, is connecting people to their next best move, whether it's recognizing that they want to be in a new grade, or that they want to do some more studying, or they want to revise their, you know, their math program. Or, you know, I love to connect people to the next step that they need to be. So connecting with people and it's the same thing, like by posing reflective questions to teachers about their next best move in the classroom, you know, there's similarities there. So, yeah, so educationally, philosophically, the song also really speaks to me, and it's powerful.
I just got to envy the people that work with you just again for a minute, because nobody has ever asked me that question. I just need a moment to tell you that listening to leaders who truly want to engage the people that they work with, I've always said that when we talk about personalization for learners, it doesn't end in the classroom. The whole school experience has to be personalized. And when you create these opportunities to personalize the teaching experience for the educators in your building, I had to take a moment and pause and smile. So, okay, let's play the song and we'll come back and talk some more. Mary J. Blige and Bono. One.
Is it getting better? Or do you feel the same? Will it make it easier on you now? You got someone to blame. You say one love, one life, one life, one need, and I, one love.
Education is such a huge part of your life, and I know that you strive to improve educational outcomes for students through supporting teachers. And hearing the song now and thinking about how it picks you up, it's such an intense endeavor and an incredible vision. Hearing it now through this conversation, how does it make you feel?
Well, it just reminds me, you know, that we have tremendous power to be catalysts for change. And, you know, in my role as a student achievement officer, which was an incredible learning opportunity, so often we would hear the word that we are provocateurs, we're provokers of thought. And I thought, you know, after doing that job for a while, I realized I want to be much more than that. And I want to be much more than that in my school. I want to be a catalyst for positive change for students, for families, for teachers, for the community. And I think that's the power of public education if we get there.
Do you talk about it at home? Because you're married to a principal from the TDSB. Like, is this education is something you live and breathe and wake up to?
It is, yeah. I'm married to an amazing principal from Toronto District School Board who pushes my thinking all the time and is incredibly talented. So yeah, we talk about education a lot, and sometimes we don't. We have to turn it off because it can be 24/7. Our two sons are 18 and 21 years old. And, you know, I've actually had my eldest son say to me, you know, Dad, I really need you right now to be my father, not a principal. And it just reminds me of the duality of our roles and how they overlap and interlope. And we talk about education a lot. We believe in public education, and we're very hopeful and sometimes drop dead exhausted by the complexities of the role. And for principals, the role is not getting any easier. So modeling that it's an amazing thing to be a principal when the workload is really almost undoable is a challenge. But that's why I strongly believe in collaborative professionalism, PPM 159, leadership for learning, because we have to tap into the leadership abilities of all the people that we work with, including our students, including our parents. And when we do that, maybe we can work to getting the job done, but the job is always changing and morphing. So I believe in public education, and I think it's an honor and a privilege to serve, however exhausting it is at the current moment with the current clientele.
I can imagine. It's funny about collaborative professionalism. You know, you mentioned that your two sons were surprised when you opened a school where technology was at the forefront, because you, like myself, are a digital immigrant. But I think that when you have collaborative professionalism, you don't need to be an expert in everything. You need to know how to tap into those experts to build your own expertise and not be afraid to be a learner.
I am so blessed to work with the most incredible leadership team at my current school. They are just so open, have a growth mindset. They're brilliant. They try new things. They allow us to enter into collaborative inquiry and, you know, learn from our actions and our mistakes and our ideas. So we have a staff meeting coming up tomorrow, and I'm going to flip the staff meeting with the help of the leadership team. So I'm really excited about that.
I want to hear about that. Well, clearly, Greg is passionate about his family and friends, living life to the fullest, equity, and helping others. If you want to get in touch with Greg, reach out through his YRDSB email, greg.farrell@yrdsb.ca. Greg, thank you so much for coming here. How are you feeling about being on the show?
It was amazing to talk with you and share my ideas and thoughts. I have to say I was really nervous about this. And thanks for making me feel so comfortable and letting me share my two cents worth and talking about, you know, songs that are powerful to me. It was a great morning. Thank you so much.
It was my true pleasure. Well, I'm going to play you out. I hope you have a great day.
Thanks, Noah. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining us on the P3, the Personal Playlist Podcast. I'm Noah Daniel. This is Voice Ed Radio, and I hope you have a fantastic day.